Hey friends, most people are surprised to learn that Microsoft has its own distribution of Linux, which we call Azure Linux. Many teams at Microsoft love the small image size of Azure Linux to host their workloads in Azure Kubernetes Service for better performance and security. Olivia and Sudhanva are here to show me how you can take advantage of its benefits today on Azure Friday. Hey friends, I'm Scott Hanselman and it's Azure Friday. Today I'm going to learn all about Azure Linux. Azure Linux, Olivia, why do we need a Linux? Why can't we just use one of the other Linuxes? We can just pick one off the shelf.
Yeah, so Azure Linux really gave us the opportunity to optimize for Azure and optimize for AKS. So we start off with like a small amount of packages. We optimize the kernel for Azure use. And then from there, we really get a product that is used by Microsoft services internally. We have about 300 services using them today. When we public previewed at Ignite last year, we ended up getting about 100 enterprise customers. And then we decided to GA at Build this week.
Rock on. Congratulations. That's amazing. Now, Sudhanva, this was formerly codenamed Mariner. Like people who are in the know might know that name, but Mariner is Azure Linux. Is that right?
Correct. So Azure Linux was the newly rebranded Mariner at Build this year. The project that's on GitHub is still CBL-Mariner, and we plan to keep it that way. So if folks browse on GitHub, you go to CBL-Mariner, and you'll still see all of our packages being built there. But the product in Azure is Azure Linux.
That's cool. And I've seen CBL-Mariner because I'm a big fan of WSL, the Windows subsystem for Linux. And that's also using CBL-Mariner and pieces of that. So there's the Azure Linux kernel is everywhere.
Yeah, absolutely. It's used internally at Microsoft, as Olivia mentioned, across bare metal, containers, VMs, and as you rightfully called out, the kernel's used in WSL. And fun fact, in WSL, the GUI version, there's an Azure Linux sidecar there as well.
That's amazing. It's everywhere and nowhere at once. We see it and we don't see it, but it's powering all of these great things. That's very cool. So do you have some demos to show me? Are we going to see this in the real world?
Yes, we are. We're going to see a three-part demo. I'll start very basic. So if you're looking to get started with Azure Linux, you can use three options, CLI, Terraform, and ARM. And today I'll show you the CLI command to get started. It really is as easy as AZ AKS create that folks are familiar with on AKS. And you just add an OS queue at the end called Azure Linux.
Okay, and so in this case here, you're making an AKS cluster using the OS SKU Azure Linux. I could, of course, use any number of them. Could I just, on my local Docker machine, just like spin up one of these? Can I make a VM with this? How many places can I use Azure Linux while we're watching for this?
Great question. So today you can use Azure Linux only in Azure on AKS. So if you're looking for local development, there are this particular OS can be spun up inside Docker. Except we do have a partnership with the Java team at Microsoft where there is an OpenJDK container based on Mariner.
Cool. Interesting. The other teams can build on top of it and have their own distros using a base image of Azure Linux.
Correct. And specifically, the OpenJDK version is the only base image we released in support today.
Okay.
While this does spin up, I do have a cluster that's ready to go with Azure Linux that we can flip to, but you can go ahead and ask Olivia the question.
All right, go ahead and zoom in there, hit control scroll and give us a nice big font. All right, so that's spinning up right there. And I did notice that Olivia, his prompt there said that he's using an AKS preview extension for his stuff. Is that required or is this something people can use today without a preview? Is this released as of build?
Yeah. Totally released. You can use Azure CLI and ARM template, and then Terraform support is coming in a few weeks.
Very cool. All right. So you just did the thing where you put a cake into the oven, Sudhanva, and you pull out a cake that's already done.
Yeah. So while the cluster deploys, I'm just going to use an existing cluster I've already deployed, and we can see that there are three nodes in this cluster, and would love to walk through the output here that shows two things that are of interest. One, under OS image, you'll see that it's based on Azure Linux. We're still changing the name from CBL-Mariner to Azure Linux slowly, because there are some folks that take dependency on this. And the other interesting note is the kernel version is 5.15. Next, we can get into the nodes. And debug things. So if I run the kubectl debug command that folks are familiar with, I just need to replace the node here with a node in my actual cluster. What this command does is it deploys the familiar .NET runtime devs container onto the node as root, and I get a shell into it.
From here, I can actually... You're in there now. You're looking at a node within the pool, and you are looking at the, probably a base shell, just SH, of Azure Linux.
Absolutely. And I want to show some of the differences and the subtleties within Azure Linux that, you know, folks might be curious about. First, you'll notice that it's based on RPM. So the package manager is DNF, not apt, or some of the other familiar package tools that people are familiar with. Olivia touched on the minimal number of packages that are in Azure Linux. So if I just do an RPM QA on count the number of lines, you'll notice that there's only 520 packages in this distribution.
Yeah, and just to touch, to add on that, some of the benefits you get from this is reduced attack surface, less CVE maintenance because you don't have as many packages to patch. So you can focus more on developing your code. And then also because it's lighter weight, you have better boot performance.
Interesting. Random old person comment. DNF is actually short for Dandified Yum. It was introduced in 2013 in Fedora. It's always funny how they're recursive acronyms where you have to unpack an acronym into another acronym that then unpacks again.
Exactly. It's like Inception.
Today I learned. Nice. So this was a cluster that was purely Azure Linux based, but if you have an existing cluster that's based on Ubuntu, you can actually add an Azure Linux node pool. So you don't need to have a homogeneous cluster that's just based on Azure Linux. And this next demo is going to show you how you can add an existing node pool or add a new Azure Linux node pool to an existing cluster. So to do that, I will switch over to a cluster that I've deployed. That it's just Ubuntu based. So if you look at this cluster, you'll see that it's Ubuntu 2204 nodes only, and there's no Azure Linux nodes on this. I'll then copy a command, and I'll just go over this command very briefly. It is az aks node pool add. I'm adding an Azure Linux node pool, name it az Linux pool, to an existing cluster.
And is that group the one that you're in right now, or did you switch to an Azure Friday group?
I switched to a group that has just an Ubuntu cluster. So
okay,
I switched
cool. So this one's Azure this Friday cluster. 2023, rather, pardon me?
Correct, yes.
All right, excellent.
So I'll kick this off, and this will add the Azure Linux node pool. And again, I have a cluster already that is deployed and has Ubuntu and Azure Linux node pool. So I'll switch over to that. Once the previous command completes and we do kubectl get nodes, the output looks like this. You'll have one AKS cluster with now six nodes in total and two node pools, so three nodes in each. You have Azure Linux nodes and Ubuntu nodes.
However, it's interesting to note that you have the OS image, the base OS image, and then you have the kernel itself. The Ubuntu kernel is still a modified Azure fork of the kernel, is it not?
Correct, and that's actually a good point. So the kernel team within Microsoft publishes a Linux kernel for use in all Linux distros, not just Azure Linux. So the Ubuntu distribution also benefits from the patching and the security of that team.
That's really cool. So even though some people might use Azure Linux, if someone's using Ubuntu, there's still pieces of Azure optimized code in there to make sure that folks have a great experience no matter what they're doing on Azure.
Correct.
Very cool. That's interesting. And
this cluster also has Dapper installed on it. And the reason I like to show this is existing extensions, open source, and first party just work seamlessly on your clusters, whether they're running Azure Linux or Ubuntu. And in this case, this is a heterogeneous cluster with both nodes, and Dapper will work seamlessly on this. no code changes to your Dapper apps or needing to change your containers.
So if I have, Olivia, an application like my the Azure Friday website, that is a pretty straightforward website, it's running .NET, or maybe I'm using Alpine, maybe I'm using Ubuntu, I can just change my base images and use Azure Linux. And as I assume all the sys calls are going to line up and my app's just going to work great.
Yeah, exactly. You can use any container you want that's Linux-based on top of the Azure Linux container host. So
and all the compatibility is there for what I need from a syscall perspective.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Very cool. Does the package manager change? You know, if I'm used to using apt or I'm used to using rel, or if I'm going to switch to a different package manager, might I have to change my Docker scripts to make sure that it's aware what the underlying package manager system is that Azure Linux is using?
So for the package management, your existing Docker files wouldn't need to change for your containers. So because you can continue using your Alpine base images or your Red Hat images, your Docker files can continue staying the same with the same scripts. And then the final image just gets deployed on the Azure Linux host and continues to run fine.
That's fantastic. I love it.
One of the things that Sudhanva touched upon was that all existing templates work on Azure Linux as they would with Ubuntu. Something that's interesting that we get to do is we get to run pre-release testing on Azure Linux. So we take AKS's tests before we release the image, run it through that, and then release it to AKS. And this way we can catch issues faster and mitigate them sooner.
So on this cluster that I had, I will quickly deploy the Dapper state store application. This application is Node.js that's talking to a Redis state that is running in Azure. And we will be using Dapper's stateful sets capabilities. So I will be applying this Node YAML. This is completely unchanged, the existing containers as is on my cluster. I will also be applying the Python deployment YAML. And this Python application, as soon as I kick this off, I will show folks briefly what it does. It talks to the local Dapper endpoint that's on the cluster, and it just creates a new order that the front end node then shows off.
Okay.
And so we can just see the orders coming in, and we made no changes to the application. The existing Dapper container images and extensions just work on this cluster that has a mixed node pool.
So do I want to expect no changes and nothing? Do I want to expect a measurable percentage of improvement? Do I want to just count on better security? You know, I wonder if it's anticlimactic. Like, you're basically telling me I'm going to move over there and it's just going to be working and awesome. What do I do with that?
A lot of the feedback we've had from the end users was that there was no disruption. And if anything, they just noticed like faster node startup times. But then again, like we were saying, the security aspect, the higher boot performance, the fact that we're creating all the packages from source and signing them in Microsoft trusted pipelines, that's another advantage that you're getting.
That's a really, really important thing. Supply chain security, yep. Right? Like if something relies on some library that some random person that we've never met, there's no provenance of the source, especially if you're taking binary. So what you're saying is that this entire thing is built from source all the way down to the kernel, and signed and checked and ensured that that is the right and correct open source software that we're going to be running on Azure.
Yep, exactly. And we also own the complete CV infrastructure as well.
Fantastic. So I can just get involved right now. Like, is there a particular website I should start at? Because I should start moving my containers over immediately.
Yeah. The website you can go to get started is the ak.ms/Azure Linux docs. This is the home for all things Azure Linux on AKS, how to get started with it, an overview of it, and you can come here to learn how to deploy with CLI, ARM templates, and as Olivia mentioned, Terraform soon.
Absolutely fantastic. Well, thank you both for spending time with us today.
Yeah, thank you so much for having us. This was fun.
I am learning all about Azure Linux and AKS today on Azure Friday.
Hey, thanks for watching this episode of Azure Friday. Now I need you to like it, comment on it, tell your friends, retweet it. Watch more Azure Friday.